Thank you so much. Wow, what a crowd, what a group. Thank you for coming. I'm a little overwhelmed. But luckily I brought some photos, so you don't have to look at me. You can look up there, and hopefully this will all go smoothly. Thank you, Bonnie. You made me sound a lot cooler than I am, a lot more impressive than I am. Photography is a wonderful profession. It's a lot of fun. It's challenging, and we're going to share some stories tonight of what it's been like, some of the travels I had, and some of the stories I've been able to encounter. In 2005, I went down to Ecuador, and interesting enough, I went down to Ecuador to study international politics and policy in Spanish. And while down there, I got to know this really wonderful country, a country of contrasts, a country of volcanoes and páramo and rainforest, a country of Galapagos and coastlines, a really fantastic country and a small country. It has a ton of resources in this very small space. And so I'm this wide-eyed 20-year-old studying international politics in one of the most beautiful countries I've ever seen. And while studying politics at the time, a really interesting thing happened. Lucio Gutierrez was being overthrown by the public. And so here I am, you know, young guy with a digital camera going out and trying to shoot photos there on the front line, getting these really angry emails from my parents saying, "Mac, you know, you gotta stay inside." Meanwhile, I'm like, "Dad, I'm learning, you know, this is international politics at its best." And while this is all happening, buses are burning outside my door. I have tanks going down the main street. Tear gas bombs are raining down in the streets. And I got this bug, and I got bit by it real bad, of going out and being right at that front line, trying to bring the public into what's going on, either politically or culturally or in natural history sense. And it's never let go of me. And shortly after that, in 2008, I went down to Honduras. Now, Honduras is a fascinating place. It's got a bad name in a lot of the press, you know, being a very unsafe place. But it's a strikingly beautiful place. And I went down there to teach kids photography, give kids photography and give them these little digital cameras, put it into their hands because it was a way to get them involved with their backyard. And this was their backyard. They lived between the Nombre de Dios and the Pico Bonito National Park mountain ranges. And the kids had a direct relationship with the natural world. They lived it and they breathed it. Their families depended upon this rich primary forest for them to be able to farm, for them to be able to hunt. And so I started exploring these relationships between people and nature. And all along this river, this is the Cangrejo River. The Cangrejo River is spurred from these primary forests that dump this spring water, this fresh water into the river. And then that river becomes a watershed, and it starts carrying it down further down to the coast, off La Ceiba, into Cayos Cochinos and Roatan. And these areas that are now fueled by this supposed to be clean, fresh water that fuels, you know, the second largest barrier reef in the world. So right at this intersection where you have people living in this wonderful ecological hotspot, right, these primary forests, you end up having a lot of problems. You have slash and burn agriculture. You have poaching that happens with a lot of the local wildlife. And so we use these cameras, putting it in the hands of these children, for them to be able to go out and speak for these landscapes for themselves, for them to start to feel pride and connected to it. And so every day we go out and we go explore these different areas. And I would, you know, I lived in this small village up in these mountains, and it was a wonderful life. It was a wonderful 2 years. And every time I'd drive by, I'd see this waterfall. And this was Bejuco Waterfall. I mean, it was massive, you know, just this water just tumbling out of primary forest. And every time I looked at it, I said, man, I got to get up there. I want to make a unique photo. So I started thinking about ways of doing it. What was I going to do? I thought, oh, I'm going to hike up to the top. I'm going to photograph it at sunrise, right as the, you know, sun is coming over the Nombre de Dios Mountains. And then I started thinking, I said, you know what would be a really cool photo is to take it halfway down. That would be awesome. And so I started talking to local guides, and I'm saying, hey, you know, you guys know this area well. How tall is that waterfall? And bless their heart, Hondurans, such nice people. Very nice to a fault, to where they want to help you out so much that they will lie to you just to think you to think that you were helped. So I'm like, how tall is this? And they're like, Mac, it's 100 feet. I go, 100 feet? They're like, mas o menos. I'm like, mas o menos? And he's like, it's 100 feet. And I said, okay, cool. I got 150 feet of rope. Excellent. I'm going to go down. I'm going to rappel down this waterfall. And once I get halfway, you know, I'm going to take this photo. And so I start rappelling down. And the idea is to get up there, you know, before dawn, rappel down, shoot this sunrise coming up. Well, I get down, and waterfalls, you know, they're convex like this. So you start coming over the edge of them, and you can't really see down. But finally, when I got about 40 or 50 feet down, all I see is my rope noodling over over rocky like cliffs and water churning everywhere. And I said, oh my gosh, this isn't going to work. And I didn't have a plan B. I had no plan B. So what I did is I tied little prussic knots that was holding my tripod, and I inched my way up, and I inched my way up. Very questionable decision from the beginning, but I got the shot. I got the shot I came for. And this is what we do a lot of times. We try to envision these things that push us to these crazy lengths sometimes just to tell a story of how these primary forests are so important to the stasis of these rivers that fuel our aquifers, that fuel the watersheds, that then fuel the reefs. So last year, I got a really unique opportunity to go to Cape Town, to South Africa, and shoot a story for the Save Our Seas Foundation. And this is a fascinating place because this is right where the Atlantic and the Indian Oceans meet. And what it forms is this temperate wilderness, essentially, this temperate water ecological hotspot. But at the same time, Cape Town, South Africa, you have this burgeoning population that is coming right up to the shores of it. And it's a beautiful place. It's fascinating, these rocky, granitic shores. And you all have probably seen it on TV. If you've seen Shark Week, you've seen what has made False Bay famous. And it's these great white sharks that come and they hunt these Cape fur seals. They'll launch out of the water and they'll come in and get them during the winter months. But what people mostly don't talk about in False Bay is that there are way more sharks than just the great white. In False Bay, there are 27 other species of sharks, and a few of them are endemic. And you start associating sharks with jaws and with big teeth and, you know, kind of this gnarly disposition. But there are lots of other sharks like this. The pajama cat shark gets its name from those stripes. Gets to wear pajamas all day. Isn't that fun? There are other sharks too. Another shark that's called a shy shark. And shy sharks get their name because when they get threatened or if they, you know, feel agitated in some way, instead of coming at you with teeth, they just curl their fin up and they put it over their eyes. And they curl into a ball. Doesn't that redefine a little bit of what a shark is like? That's a shark. I got to swim with the seven-gill cow sharks. These are really cool. They have these kind of granny Muppet mouths. And they're just so friendly, always smiling. You know, always very happy to be around. Pleasure to swim with. Fascinating place. So at the same time when you have this explosive shark population, you also have this urban population. So what happens in the summertime when the waters warm up? What do people do? What do we do in Florida? Flock to the beach. We go right to the beach. South Africans do it the same way. They all go to the beach. But biologically, there's another process that's happening. Because as those waters warm up, sharks start to leave that seal island. They start following schools of fish further inshore. And while people are using this resource more and more, one of the most popular surfing spots in the world is at Muizenberg Beach here in False Bay. So what happens as you're having these sharks that are coming in, following these schools of fish, and increase water users? Eventually, you have some negative consequences. This is Ahmad Hassim. This is a Paralympic medalist now. He was bit by a shark in Muizenberg Beach, but has now become one of the most outspoken advocates for shark conservation, because he believes that protecting these sharks and protecting these waterways is very important, not only to maintaining the ecological health of the waterway, but also to making sure that people acknowledge that when they get in the water, they're sharing it with something else. So what has Cape Town done? Instead of killing all their sharks, what they've done is they've started coming up with a unique, non-lethal, sustainable solution. they created this program called Shark Spotters, where they take these kids from the inner city, from the townships in these, you know, really close-quartered living situations. They've given them a full-time job. They put one shark spotter up on the mountain, one down on the beach. They spot with binoculars. As soon as they see a shark, they raise a flag that says sharks in the water. And all of a sudden, people come out of the water. The shark follows its fish. It moves on. They lower the flag, and people are free to go back in the water. How about that? That is a great solution, isn't it? That's wonderful. Yeah, sure, they deserve a hand for that, definitely. And I think that's what's really interesting. These are the lines that I like to ride, are what are the decisions that we make when people and nature meet? How do we deal with it? It's a fun job. People oftentimes talk about it being like this Indiana Jones lifestyle because they see photos like this, me photographing out of a plane. And yeah, there are some cool moments where I have to pinch myself and I say, I can't believe this is my life, but most of the time it looks like this. This is about 90% of what my life looks like. Because I'm a swamp and I'm a wetland photographer. This is my office. This is actually, disregard the look on the face, that's my comfort zone. That's my sweet spot. But what makes our experiences perhaps a little bit different and a little more unique than that of the average traveler is that when bad things happen or when times get tough, when situations get a little bleak, like when you're broken down on the side of Dead Dog Road in the Everglades in the summer, you think, there might be a photo to be made here. There might be a story to be told. And storytelling is really important. Really important, especially here in the Southeast, because there is an alarming disconnect between the public and these natural systems that allow us to be here in the first place. And I grew up flipping through magazines and, you know, scratch and sniff books. I am a visual person, and maybe most of you are too. That's why you come here to see a show about photos and photography. And we use what we see to teach us what we know. Now, if the majority of us aren't going to go willingly wade into a blackwater swamp or a wetland on our own accord, then how can we then expect those same people to then advocate on behalf of those wetlands, on behalf of those swamps, on behalf of those forgotten areas that make the Southeast so unique, so interesting? So my job then is to use photography, to use my camera as a communication tool, right, to get the public engaged, get them thinking, and maybe talking, and hopefully, ultimately, to get them caring. And we have a lot of unique ways of doing this. We're sneaky people, photographers. We're very sneaky. We want you, when you look at our photos, to say, wait a minute, where is the photographer in this? And we have a lot of ways of doing that. I like to use camera traps. So I'll put out my camera, and I'll do silly little tests like this, to try to see where wildlife is going to come in, come out. And sometimes you can get lucky. Sometimes if you stake out an area long enough and you get a bottleneck where birds like to come, you can get glimpses that would otherwise evade us. Perspectives like this. And then we'll take it a little further and I'll dig a hole and I'll put my camera in that hole and have it looking up and see what a bug's eye perspective looks like. Isn't that fun? It's a good time, it's fun, it's problem solving, and it's active, and this is what we like to do. We like to get into these new worlds and show people a new window into maybe something that's a familiar subject. And I started doing this about 15 or 16 years ago when I was in high school, right up in Gainesville, Florida. And I fell in love with it. I fell in love with Gainesville, where my other friends would say, oh, you know, I'm so bored, it's the weekend, there's nothing to do here. I would say, I beg to differ. There's lots. There was so much to see just around my little house. And I grew up in a house just like a lot of other people in a little kind of suburban area. But Gainesville was full of all kinds of wildlife. And not just Gainesville, Florida. Places that make it look like some fanciful Jurassic world. And that's the way I felt. And so I took my dad's old SRT Minolta 101 as that tank of a film camera. I took it out. And I started exploring more and more. And I would wake up before the first period bell would ring in high school and I'd go shoot sunrise. And I'd tell my friends about it. And I'd tell my extended family who lived up north in Virginia and in New York and places like that. And they'd say, well, Mac, what you're describing doesn't sound like Florida. Florida's like golf courses and beaches. And then I say, no. The real Florida, the heart of the real Florida, is something entirely different. It's a narrative that's not talked about a lot, but it's one that's certainly worth exploring and paying attention to. Because the more you see, the more you start to see, the more you reveal. And I get pretty lucky. Sometimes I get to go real close with wildlife. And I like getting to on those low angles, you know, getting low with a camera gives that perspective that something is much bigger than it really is. And I like that because it projects the way that I feel about Florida and the Southeast, is that it very much is this Jurassic world. We live with reptiles and old dinosaurs. Isn't that fun? Sometimes they let me get close, sometimes they don't. Sometimes they've had enough. I let them move on to do their thing. But a lot of people think you have to go to these far-flung places all over the world to capture beauty or to see wonderful things. But I advocate all the time that it's where you live. It's these local spots where you can make the most difference and where you can take the best photos because you know it and you learn it and you feel it. So I would go and I'd shoot these photos of these live oak. That it's like the oak that all trees want to aspire to be. I mean, that's a magnificent tree. And then, you know, a month later, I'd say, well, what does this look like under moonlight when the fog rolls in? The same subject photographed a totally different way. And I'd say, well, you know, that's cool, but what does it look like if I put a flashlight behind it? And I open up the shutter for 10 minutes. Isn't that fun? And then one day I'm eating dinner with my parents. My mom's so sweet. She always makes wonderful, wonderful meals. She said, Mac, do you want to have dinner with us tonight? And I said, yeah, but that's like right at sunset time, so it's kind of good light and it's hard to walk out on that. She goes, okay. I was like, okay, Mom, you know, I'll eat with you. And so we're eating, and I'm constantly looking back over my shoulder, looking through the window to see what the light's doing. And the light, it's mixing with these storm clouds that are coming down. So sunset and storm clouds, it's the best possible combination. So I said, Mom, sorry, I love you, got to go. Grab my camera, I run out the road, and because this is happening. Yeah, shooting local. You know, the same subject, photographed in many different ways. And this is what I liked about it. Because growing up here, you got insight into different places, into these different ecosystems that are all within a stone's throw. And despite all these years that have passed, when I first started in high school, I have never really matured with my relationship with nature. I still see it, you know, with the eyes of a child. I try to communicate that. So I try to come across with messages of curiosity and wonderment in my photography. These birds are so cool. Yeah, it's like an owl selfie. These are burrowing owls. Someone told me it could be like the mascot for Angry Birds that game. I think so. I think it's pretty close at least. These are cool birds. These are called burrowing owls. And they get their name because they don't have nests in trees. They burrow underground. And they're really cool birds. And most of the time when you see photos of them, you see them like this, with long lenses, telephotos, right, shot from a distance. But I wanted to make something a little bit different because when I came to the airfield in Homestead, Florida, which is just north of Everglades National Park, I would contract pilots out of there to do aerial photography. And so right before we're getting on one of the helicopters, I look over and I see this, and there's a bunch of road cones set out and a little bird sitting on top. I'm like, what is that? And the person I was with is like, well, those are the burrowing owls. I was like, oh, okay. Like, I didn't know they were supposed to be here. He goes, yeah. I was like, what are the road cones for? And they say, well, so the landscape company doesn't come and mow over the burrows. They put these and they set them out. So now the burrowing owls are starting to use them as pedestals to keep a watch over. So I started thinking, I started saying, so the burrowing owls are used to these road cones. And they say, yeah. I go, huh. So what I did, I grab a road cone, I carve out a hole, I put my camera in it, put a strobe at the bottom, and within 5 minutes, burrowing owl is just showing right up to the road cone. If you see him down there in the bottom left, and there's my lens. But this offers a unique problem, actually. Because where's that burrowing owl looking? Yeah, out the other way, right? So I'm sitting there trying to take photos all day, and all I'm getting is this. They couldn't care less. I, like, disguised the camera too much. And so they're like these daydreaming birds that just watch clouds all day. And I'm racking my brain thinking, what am I going to do? How am I going to get photos of these birds actually looking at me? And so it just came to me instantly. When you put your camera on a timer, it makes a little beep, beep noise. So I programmed it to do that. I said, okay, it's going to go beep, beep, and then click, right? So I programmed it, put it back in the row cone, and sure enough, first thing, beep, beep, click. Isn't that wild? It's crazy. These birds are fascinating. I keep doing it over weeks, and you just get the funniest photos. Beep, beep, click. Yeah. It's just always photo bombing owls. Sometimes they're still not paying attention. They're just, you know, looking at potential predators or clouds. But then you come down and you get moments like this, of candid moments that shows the owl in its habitat, that tells a little more of the story of the owl. What's it like? What does he think? What does he feel? And that's what we go for. And so one time I set out my camera and did this over a series, a little series of time, and it made this time-lapse video, which is hilarious to me. Because you see just how neurotic these birds are. This is all they do is hang around their burrow and look for predators all day, just watching, looking at clouds, going back in the burrow, coming out. This is their life. And they were nice enough to give me a little glimpse into their life. Florida. Florida's wild. There's a blank canvas. There's a blank canvas. We have wilderness that we can explore at any chance that we want to. Animals that live here, they don't really live in other places. And so you can fill that blank canvas with all kinds of things. You can fill it with adventure. Adventure enough to, you know, run your imagination wild. When I saw this tree for the first time, I thought, okay, that's a really cool tree. I got to come back and shoot it. But more importantly, I thought, that's a cool tree. I need to come back and sleep in it. And so I spent an entire weekend spent just to sleeping in this tree and illuminating it and using photography as this means to get me out to make me do these little fun adventures. And so I shot this all night. You know, I'd set up my 10-foot tripod in a lake just over the water's edge, and I'd sit on an intervalometer. I'd paddle out. I'd go light up the hammock, come back down, do it again, all night. And then eventually I waited till the next day when the full moon was rising just over the horizon. And it does just what the sun does when it rises. It paints this amber glow, you know, right across the horizon. And just as the moon started to rise, you get stuff like this. It's fun. It was a ton of fun that whole weekend. And this was the purpose of going out there. But what I was awarded with when doing this was a lot of unexpected things. Things that I didn't know happened while I was out there. That these birds take on these hierarchical systems, where you have egrets down at the bottom and the vultures up at top. I had no idea they did that at night when they go to roost. It's cool. Wake up in the morning, you see trees walking on water. And the whole reason of going out there for these hammock photos and trees gave me all kinds of other new material. You know, when you just get out and you go see it and you allow yourself to be surprised, I guarantee you will. And you can get surprised all the time. Stick your head under the water. See what we have. Because what we have here exists nowhere else. Crystal clear springs. Wonderful birds that are used to people. How fun is that? 6 inches from this double-crested cormorant. Didn't seem to care. Just held his chin up nice and proud. I've been photographing in Central America, South America, Africa, and I can honestly tell you that what we have here in Florida, what we have in the Sunshine State in the Southeast, rivals anything else that I've seen. But yet so much of our narrative is tied to this idea that these ecosystems that determine our aquifers and our drinking water, these have all been called as scary and spooky and dangerous for the longest time, ever since we came here, actually. These were called spooky. And you got to wonder where the idea came from. It was actually a very real myth that we sowed. Because when we were fighting the Revolutionary War, we said, oh, no, Brits, don't go into the swamp. Those are haunted places. They're full of ghosts and evil spirits. Because that's where we went, to hide out and to seek refuge. So these swamps became these refuges for us. But somehow this myth that these are, you know, spooky and dangerous and scary places has pervaded the generations, has pervaded the centuries. And it's kept the public silent and disinterested for the most time. And it's led to this real disconnect between these natural systems that define our natural heritage, define our cultural heritage. And it's led to some really big problems. And for the longest time, these swamps and these wetlands have been considered as these second-class ecosystems because they had very little monetary value. You know, it wasn't like the plains where you could just put up houses and developments everywhere. No, swamps were only really good for draining and timbering. And they're also full of all kinds of things, right? Things that people don't want to be around. Things that I reveled in. I love these. These are cottonmouths. Everyone says, oh, they're so aggressive, right, that they'll chase you. But they're super considerate. You get close, and they let you know you're too close, and then you can back away, and you do your thing. I used to use photos like this to leverage telephoto lenses out of my parents. Take note, any kids in the audience. This is a good technique. I built an arsenal out of fear. It's great. But the more that we've come to learn and actually study about these swamps and these wetlands, the more secrets we're unlocking. And the more we're learning about the interconnectedness of habitats and species and flyways. Fun things. Things we're learning that didn't happen all the time, right? I didn't actually ride this gator to get this photo. No gator was harmed in this, but I do love the look on that turtle's face. We call this one between a gator and a hard place. What I did is I rigged up my camera to this log because every time I would paddle up to it, the gators and the turtles would, you know, jump off. They don't want to be anywhere near people. So instead what I did is I put my camera, I attached it to the log, and it arced up and over, and I took a photo every 10 minutes for about 2 weeks, and you get some fun things. These, you know, this daily competition between sunbathers of who's going to take it. Fun perspectives of, you know, when it rained, yeah, my camera got ruined a couple times. But you get fun photos. And then you clean it off and you get gator butts. But this, to me, fueled that idea that we live with dinosaurs. I mean, that is wild looking. Armored dinosaurs in our backyards all the time. These interactions between turtles and gators. I learned a lot just while doing this project. I had no idea that stuff like this happened. Can you believe that? Unexpected friends, I guess. I don't know. But you learn a lot about swamps the more that we're studying them, the more we're coming to find out about them. This is the Prothonotary warbler. This is a fascinating bird, and it's about this big. It's a little yellow bird, and you wouldn't think this is a swamp bird because you think a swamp bird has to have fangs and a forked tongue and like gnarly talons. This guy is a swamp bird through and through. And they nest and they breed and they mate in these old growth swamps. Can you see them right there in the cypress knee? And they are one of only two cavity nesting warblers in the country. So cavity nesters like to nest in cavities. They depend on these old-growth swamps because they have all the factors they need. They have clean water, they have old decaying growth, and they have this new growth, and it's a perfect habitat for them to live in. Okay, so these old-growth swamps are fueling this population of this little bird about this big. And the more scientists are coming to learn about these birds, they're setting out these decoys and they're catching them in these mist nets. And what they're doing is they're equipping them with these little, most adorable backpack ever. It's about this big. It's a little GPS backpack, and they equip them with them, and then they let them fly off, and they band them. And they're equipping them with these GPS because they're learning something fascinating, that when these birds leave, they go, and they fly 5,000 miles, and they fly 5,000 miles south, a bird this big. And then they winter in Central and South America. And then when the spring starts to roll around, they take their chicks that they just raised, and they fly 5,000 miles back. And what the GPS is telling us is that when they come back, they don't just go, you know, to another state or another forest or another swamp or wetland. They come right back to the same exact tree. That is crazy. Who used a GPS to get here tonight? I did. I use them in my hometown. I mean, I can't live without this thing, and yet this bird, the size of a tennis ball, can make a 10,000-mile journey back to the same spot. That's crazy. It's amazing. And it's what we're starting to finally learn now that we've protected some of these swamps and these wetlands. We're beginning, even in 2016 and 2015, to still learn new things. But despite all this rich in wildlife that abounds, swamps still have a bad name. Many people feel a little uncomfortable with the idea of wading into Florida's black water. But this is what I liked about growing up here in the Sunshine State, is that for many of us, our minds are wired a little bit differently than that of the northerners, right? Every fall, our house can be swept away by hurricanes. We can be flooded out. We live with this kind of reverence, I think, to nature. And we know that when we stick our toes in the water, there might be something much more ancient and much more adapted than we are. But I think being humbled is an okay thing, especially now in this urban and digital and modern age. It's okay to feel vulnerable. It's okay to feel humbled. It's encouraging, in fact. And I loved it. I attached to that feeling. Whenever I would go out into the woods, I thrived on that, and I tried to capture that through my photography. And I learned to view all these, what other people call as, you know, scary things or impediments or obstacles to overcome. I viewed them as affirmations that I'd found wilderness, and it wasn't far at all from my backyard. It was my backyard in most cases, actually. But so obsessed with swamps and wetlands, I decided to go down to the most famous swamp of all. The Everglades. Because for me, growing up in Gainesville, I don't know about y'all, but you hear it all the time, Fakahatchee and Corkscrew and Big Cypress, all these places that just beckon exploration. And so a young guy headed down south to explore these areas and then to hopefully reveal and rewrite and retell this story of the Everglades in maybe a new and maybe a more inspiring light. Because when you talk about the Everglades, people think, okay, mosquitoes, gators, and now pythons, right? And they talk about it like it's this really hectic place that things are hanging around all over just waiting to eat you, but it's not like that. It is serene. It is peaceful. It is one of the most peaceful places I've been. It is not like that. I never really even wore bug spray when I was down there that whole time, or a bug suit for that matter. It's a fascinating place. And people associate it with the national park all the time. So when you say Everglades, they say national park. But the Everglades is not just a national park. That's the southern end of the system. The Everglades is a system. It's a watershed, which is about 100 miles long and over 50 miles wide. It occupies roughly a third the state of Florida. So you can't contain it in that one protected area. And what defines the Everglades is this water, this river of grass that moves slowly southward. Starts in Lake Okeechobee and overflows, historically, used to overflow its banks. And that water would then get into those pond apple groves, these ancient groves that would house the epiphytes and the orchids that has made the Everglades famous. The ghost orchid is one of the famous orchids that's there. A very rare plant to see, indeed. And as those summer storms rage and they come through Florida and they sweep through, it's providing a very tangible ecological factor that's important to this system. Because in the summer, as those waters come up through rain, it slowly fills up. And as it does, periphyton starts to grow. This is the cyanobacteria mix that is the bedrock, the foundation of the food base of the Everglades system. Little demersal fish eat this stuff, and then the wading birds eat those fish, and then the crocs and the gators eat those. This is what the building block is. And as that river of grass moves southward, it gets into these cypress domes and these cypress sloughs. These are fascinating places of old Florida. And if you're looking down at the water, you might see a little scurrying of insects and animals. These are called whirligig beetles, and they rest right on top of the water's edge. You have them here in Ocala, too. And alone, a single one is dead meat. But all together, they're called whirligig beetles because they scatter and they move so quickly, and that's to confuse predators. And as you're walking through these cypress forests, you're looking down at the ground, you're looking around, you're looking up at the trees, and if you're not paying attention, you're going to miss the barred owl that's calling out to its mate from the limb. You see it? It's a fun place. It's full of life. Life is everywhere. Life is above. Life is beneath. These are my favorite plants. These are called limibacopa. And limibacopa is great for me because when I'm out in the field, you're walking along it, they release this lemony zest type pine saw scent, which is excellent if you're not showering for a few days. And you don't have to explain to your wife later. Say, oh, it's pine saw bath. It's great. It's beautiful. This submerged aquatic vegetation thrives on the seasonality of water, and that water moves further south into the mangrove flats. And the mangrove flats then start condensing more and more. They start condensing more and more into these tunnels. And these mangrove tunnels start feeding that black water, that fresh water that is so vital to the estuary of Florida Bay. And this is the final stop of fresh water in the Everglades system. It's an estuary, and estuaries depend on fresh water. This is an 850 square mile estuary. So the Everglades is a fascinating place that's defined by the seasonality of water. High rain in the summer, dry season in the winter. And that is what fuels the whole Everglades system to make it this national treasure that we know it. But unfortunately, the Everglades story is not just sunshine and rainbows. For better or for worse, the story of the Everglades is intrinsically tied to these peaks and these valleys of our relationship with the natural world. But I do that. I like to show you these beautiful pictures and these wonderful vistas and these fun wildlife because it gets you here and it gets you on board. And when I have your attention, I can tell you that what's really happening to the Everglades is that we have taken this and we have turned it to this. And we're doing it at an alarming rate. And just like we've seen in South Africa, just like we've seen in Honduras, is that decision time. What are we going to do? What are the decisions that we make when we come right up front with wilderness? Here in Florida, we have a unique opportunity. And actually, that's what brought people down here in the first place. They saw Florida as opportunity. They saw this big wetland, this nasty Everglades that was fit only for alligators and snakes and mosquitoes. They said, let's drain it. Let's make room for agriculture. And not just for the few thousand Floridians that were there, but let's make enough for the millions of Americans that were everywhere. It was a subtropical paradise. And in fact, at the time, draining a swamp to make way for agriculture and development was the very essence of conservation. That's what defined conservation. So we cut down the trees, we put up a whole bunch of agriculture, we started growing year-round oranges, enough for everyone. Wonderful. That was the initial idea. That's what we've done. And we've taken this system that took 6,000 years to build of these summer rains coming through and building, making this river of grass, and we've turned it today into this river of sugarcane. Over 500,000 acres. It's nuts. And so I like to do this. I like to get up in airplanes. I like to get up in helicopters and shoot these aerial stuff because this is what gives us context. And context is so important when you're telling a story. How does this fit in? Well, when you're looking at eye level in Florida, you don't see too far, right? You just kind of see what's right in front of you. You get up and you can see how these massive swaths of sugarcane are stretching until the horizon ends. And these are the fields that are responsible for dumping these exceedingly high levels of nutrients into the system, changing it. But not only getting up over the air, I like to get underwater too. And my parents were always uneasy when I'd say, Mac, or I'd say, yeah, I'm going to go snorkel in the Everglades. Mom didn't like that, but it's a lot different than what people think it is. They think it's this murky, muddy, mire. But it's not. That water historically was cleaner than Evian. Crystal clear waters down in the Everglades and cypress domes, followed down further south, and you have these prehistoric garfish that lurk in the waters. And everyone likes to come down to the Keys and they like to go swimming around the coral reefs. Well, those coral reefs are there because the Everglades is there. All those coral reefs, all this life that abounds, is made possible by a watershed that starts 100 miles north. And so while people are swimming around these reefs, I like to tell them, Guys, you need to move on the interior of Florida Bay because a real party is at the mangroves. These are fascinating ecosystems because what looks like this homogenous system on top, right? These waxy green leaves that everything looks the same. Well, as soon as you stick your head underwater, it is like a kaleidoscope of colors. Algae and sponges and invertebrates, these are the nurseries where the fish hang out. These are the places that create this world-class fishery that we've come to know in Florida Bay and South Florida. And there's all kinds of small stuff, too. I'd bring my field studio out. We collect, find some fun little wildlife that's there. Starfish. Some wildlife's not too happy to see me. Some wildlife that's only an inch tall. This is mermaid's wine glass. There's a print of it right over there. Awesome. Little macroalgae. This is what the little fish feed on. Other small things, baby terrapins, mangrove terrapins, lettuce sea slugs. That's, their skin seems to breathe as it unfurls. It's so cool to watch. These guys can make their own energy. They photosynthesize. They're about an inch tall. But mangroves are important not only for these coastal defenses that help abate climate change and help make us make our coastlines a little more fortified. They're also important nurseries for bigger fish, sharks. And it's fascinating if you go down there. If you ever drive down that Dixie Highway and you drive down south on US 1, you'll see it on the sides of roads, just mangroves and mangroves and mangroves. It all looks the same. Well, if you go there at low tide, it's going to be hard as a rock. It's going to feel just like the floor. But if you wait a couple of hours, that water will start percolating through the limestone. It'll start coming up. And within an hour, you'll be under 4 feet of water. And as you're under 4 feet of water, these horseshoe crabs start to come in. The swimming crabs start to come in. And what follows them are over between 40 and 50 little lemon shark pups. It's so cool to see. These systems and these relationships between wildlife and these natural systems are the way I like to view them. I like to understand the way a system works through the wildlife that has to depend on it. Isn't that a good way? So this is what I like to do with my photography. I like to create narratives based on the wildlife that lives it, making indicator species for these systems. So in telling a story about the Everglades, instead of just showing a whole bunch of pictures that don't necessarily connect, I like to break it down into different narratives. Like this, starting with the Lake Okeechobee. This is the beating heart of the Everglades. Well, what species represents Lake Okeechobee in the northern Everglades any better than the Everglades snail kite? These are fascinating birds. And if you look closely, you'll see they have this really hooked bill, they have curved talons, and they have broad, broad wings. And it's not a coincidence. These are one of the most specialized raptors in the world. And specialized because they eat one thing. They eat one source of food called an apple snail. So they have those long curved talons because they don't produce oil on their wings, so they want to stay dry. So when going to catch these snails, they can grab them real quick. And then they have that hooked bill so they can get under the operculum of the apple snail and they can pull out that meat. They have those broad wings so they can sail a long time over those wetlands to be able to find enough to find the prey without expending too much energy. So what happens when you have this really specialized bird that depends on an apple snail? What happens when you take that system and you mechanize it? A system that used to expand and contract naturally, those marshes that seem to go on forever, a lot of habitat for these snails. You regulate that habitat, and all of a sudden, it's gone. And as soon as you destroy a habitat for the apple snail, populations for the Everglades snail kite started dropping dramatically. We're up to around 400 nesting pairs today. It's an endangered species, and it has a really tough time here. So I want to make photos that connect people with it, that get them inspired and get them pumped up, because these birds are so cool. So what I do is I like to draw pictures. I draw pictures like a director would, and I storyboard a lot of my images. And I send them to biologists that are qualified enough to put me in the areas where they're going to be prevalent. And we try to make these drawings come into life through photography. And here's a little backstory video on how we did it. F- photographing the Everglades snail kite was definitely one of the most challenging and stressful projects I've ever taken on. The majority of their population exists in and around Lake Okeechobee, which is the seventh largest freshwater lake in the United States. It's a huge area. And unlike other raptors, the snail kite feeds on one source of food, just one, the apple snail. But the apple snail lives underwater most of the time, really only coming up just to breathe, mate, or lay eggs. So kites are constantly soaring over the vegetation, scanning and searching for this prey, which is about the size of a ping pong ball. So this bird is basically able to find a needle in a haystack. I had to find some unique way to photograph that. So I went to Lake Okeechobee. I knew it was going to take a lot of preparation, but because of the size of the area, I also knew it was going to take some sort of bottleneck. So I teamed up with state wildlife biologists, and we built this submersible platform out of PVC, which would contain the snails just right at the top of the water column, along with a camera that I could trigger remotely. So day after day, I'm hauling all my gear out into the water. I'm just sitting in my canoe for 9-hour shifts, just waiting, And it was miserable. I began to get really discouraged when things were unsuccessful. You're left with your own thoughts, and doubt really starts to creep in. Am I keeping the birds away? Is the camera keeping the birds away? And there's no way of knowing. And so you're constantly at battle with that part of you that just wants to say, I should just go shoot this with a telephoto lens and just be done with it. 4 days passed and I had nothing to show. And I actually started to think that the image was impossible. But I decided to give it one more effort, and so I returned to Lake Okeechobee. And after setting up the platform in a new flight line, I look off and I see a kite coming over the cattails. And I see him scanning and searching. And he gets right over the trap and he looks down. And I see that he sees it. And he beelines, he goes straight for the trap.
Yes.
And in that moment, all those months of planning, waiting, all the sunburns, mosquito bites, suddenly,
oh my god,
they're all worth it.
I can't believe it.
Oh my god, I love it.
This is crazy.
Thanks. Yeah. Isn't that fun? That's fun. It was fun. After it worked. And the video is mostly true, for the most part. What it doesn't say is that the first few days I had a good friend, and he wanted to come with me, and you know, he's all stoked about this project too. And I said, Christian, you know, you're going to come out? He goes, oh yeah, definitely, I'm going to be there. It's going to be great. Well, after day one of nothing happening, I could see, you know, he's a little worn down. He's like, that's okay, Mac, we'll get it tomorrow. So I go out again the next day, and then after the next day of nothing happening, I can see on his face, and he's like, that's okay, Mac, you'll get it tomorrow. And so, you know, day three, I'm like, hey, Christian, you want to come with me? And he's like, oh, you know, I got laundry. So the whole next week, I just set out by myself. And finally, when I do see the kites going in this new flight line, and I set out the trap, I'm by myself. I'm a little crazy at this point, like just talking to myself. And I'm hiding in these cattails. And all of a sudden, I mean, it's golden light. It's the best possible light you could ask for. And the kites just start hitting it. They just start going at it. And I am freaking out by myself. And I'm like, yes! Oh, I'm brilliant! This is the best! Oh, I'm so excited! And, you know, talking to myself really loud. And the sun sets, and then I wade over to the camera trap, and I go, and I get the camera out of the trap, and I press play, and not one photo is taken. Not one. Yeah, talk about human-machine cognition. We need to fix those remotes. It did not work. But I knew that it could work. And over the next 4 days is when we got to make photos like this. Glimpses like this where the snail explodes off the water. And then my favorite photo, where you have that tension, the snail, the kite looking at it, this one, that eventually became the cover of the book. It was a fun project, and I learned a lot about these birds just by watching, just by sitting in the water all day with them. They're fascinating. But you can't tell an Everglades story without talking about gators. You definitely can't, because they're important. They're interesting. And I've always had a really close and my parents think it's a precarious relationship with alligators. I loved it. I loved growing up with them. I loved growing up in a town that celebrated the gators. They're cool. They're ubiquitous. They're everywhere. But they're actually one of our country's most successful conservation stories. Because in the mid-20th century, we actually hunted them to near extinction. Near extinction. Can you believe that? An alligator. And within 20 years, they started coming back, and we started seeing them everywhere. Now we have over 1 million in this state. Good job. Go U.S. Yeah, definitely. And FSU. Sometimes FSU. But we always think about them as these apex predators that are always dominating a system, when in fact they are very much a part of the system, just like anything else. But in the Everglades, they're wired a little bit differently. They have a different behavior than that of other alligators in northern states because of the specific thing that they do that is tied to that seasonal drawdown of water in the Everglades. Wet season in the summer, dry season in the winter. Well, how is an animal that needs to stay wet and it needs to be able to forage, how is that going to survive a dry season? So what they do, what they've started to do, is started excavating. They've started moving earth, physically altering the landscape around them to suit their needs. And they create these things called gator holes. And gator holes are these depressions. So when the water starts drying up in the winter, they can be able to stay wet and forage year round. They're smart. And other animals have started depending on this too, which makes them a keystone species. And in areas of the Everglades, deep in the Everglades, where you go, where gators haven't seen people in a long time, you can see this taking place. In the winter, you would come to these places where the water is just barely this deep. And I came out one time and I was, you know, trying to photograph the effect of these gator holes on these alligators and the seasonality of water. And I came to this scene where gators just started leaping out of the water and crashing down so they could be able to eat. I'd never seen this behavior before. And it is born of this habitat that they've created. They are the architects of the Everglades. So I came back a couple weeks later, hoping to see that the water had dried up even more, and this is a particularly dry year. And when I came back, you see all these paths of desire leading out of the forest into the only wet spots that there were left. This is one of the last remaining gator holes. And it looks like there's only one gator in this photo, but if you look closely, they're over 40 here. They're just buried. And this is what they do. They wait it out. They wait it out. They are adapted to the seasonality of water flow in the Everglades. And they'll do anything to stay wet. They'll hide in trees. They're smart. And so looking just west of this, I looked out with my friend and I saw, you know, over 100 razorbacks just kind of sticking out of the mud. And I told my friend Mark, very good friend, the only friend who I would do this with, I said, hey, you want to go out there? There's a photo I want to make. And he looks at me like you're crazy, and he says, yes. Those are the kinds of friends you keep. And I'm faster than him. Probably not. So we start heading out, and we start sludging through this gator hole, this mud pit, and it just smells of urine and rotting fish, and you can feel it's the most uncomfortable situation I've ever been in, that I put myself in, let's be honest here, and you feel gators wriggling under your feet, the ones that are trying to get deep. It's the most uncomfortable thing, and we get to the middle, and I get right to the spot where I want, and I bend over, hold my breath, I click two frames, and I do the stupidest thing you could have done, and I just get right up like I'd just forgotten where I was, and all of a sudden the gators just flip out, and they just are slashing mud all around, luckily going that way, not this way. But we went out there to take a photo of this relationship between gators and the seasonality of water, and luckily we got the photo. Scary place, but a fun place. And when that water returns, it heads south, just like the river of grass is meant to do. It heads south, and it goes down to Florida Bay, that last receiver of water. And as these storms come across Florida Bay, it makes one heck of a light show. It's unbelievable. Sometimes they make these nuclear looking clouds, you know, situations, these perfect mirrored landscapes. Really cool colors that you don't see anywhere else in Florida, these emerald greens and these dark blues, these gnarly landscapes, the last receiver of water. And as you're boating in Florida Bay, it's not too uncommon to have a whole pod of dolphins following your wake, jumping in and out of them, chasing fish. But Florida Bay is a shallow estuary, and shallow meaning really shallow. It used to be story that you could walk all the way from Cape Sable, the southern point of Florida, all the way down to the Keys. That's how shallow it is. So when you have shallow water that receives a whole lot of sunlight, you get submerged aquatic vegetation, and lots of it. Seagrass beds that extend for miles. And it's these seagrass beds that give the life that we all love, the fishes and the lobsters and the dolphins and all these things that make the Everglades, are these submerged aquatic vegetation. And when you have a lot of fish, you have a lot of birds. And in the winter, right now, this is the best time to go down there because, one, no mosquitoes, and two, you get lots of American white pelicans that come down for the winter. And when I say lots, I mean a lot. They make islands white. It's unbelievable. And speaking of islands, the mangrove islands that dot Florida Bay are fascinating in and of themselves. These are these places of high endemism because they are far from the mainland. Far from the mainland. So you have these wading bird colonies, the great white herons that are out there. You have cormorants that nest there. And when you're far from the mainland, when you're far removed from where raccoons and rats and snakes are, you start feeling pretty cavalier. And you can nest on the ground there without harm. And you get out of the wind because it's easier to nest on the ground. And so for a couple months, I followed this family of ospreys. Got to see them from up close with a remote camera. Got to see them deliver food to their babies. It's cool. The islands are fun. And on those islands is a really unique bird. A really unique bird called the roseate spoonbill. These are really fun birds. And pretty birds, too. Until you get to their face area. Then you're like, what happened? You're doing so well. And then, oh. Almost. But these birds are really unique because what has happened is they've had an interesting relationship with the Everglades because there used to be thousands of them. When the early explorers came here, there are thousands of nesting pairs in Florida Bay. That was the hot spot for them on those islands. But at the turn of the 20th century, just as the plume trade started picking up, we brought them down to two nesting pairs in Florida Bay. Because the roseate spoonbill pelt fetched more than gold did at the time. So this was like a treasure trove for poachers. So luckily what we did is the government stepped in and they banned the plume trade. Great. Wonderful. And what happened? We made policies and the birds rebounded. They started coming back by the hundreds and then by the thousands. And as they started coming back, biologists started paying attention to them. How are these birds interacting? How are they responding with the wetland, with this ecosystem? And what they found out is something really interesting, is that these birds, they wait to nest until the winter, until the dry season starts. Now, why do they do that? Why would a bird need to wait until the winter to do that? Well, the roseate spoonbill has an interesting biology. They are tactile feeders. If you ever watch them, they have this kind of crazed, you know, feeding motion. And what they're doing is they're creating these little whirlpools in the water column as they move their bill back and forth. And as they do that, fish are culled into these little whirlpools, and as soon as they touch them, that's when they can feed them. So a spoonbill is a tactile feeder. And as a tactile feeder, what's going to happen if the water's super high and the fish are all dispersed everywhere? It's going to be hard to catch enough, right? So what they do is they wait till the wintertime as the water drops down to be able to feed enough to start feeding their young. So the fish are concentrated in these pools now during the dry season. And as they're feeding, that's when they start nesting. Okay? So this is a bird that's directly tied to the mechanism that makes the Everglades, the annual drawdown cycle of water. Mix that with a healthy submerged aquatic vegetation population, a healthy demersal fish population, and boom, a healthy spoonbill means a healthy Everglades. Great, we have an ecological indicator for the health of the Everglades right there on the island in beautiful pink fashion. So we're studying them and we're finding more and more out about them. And then just in the late 20th century, what did we start to do as these birds are rebounding, coming back, 1,100 birds, 1,200 birds, 1,400 birds? Well, we started carving up the southern Everglades. And we stopped 2/3 of that water from moving south. And what effect does missing 2/3 of fresh water in an estuary have? Well, you start getting higher salinities. And as you get higher salinities, you start hearing about all these things we're hearing about today. The big die-offs, the algal blooms, the die-offs of the seagrass beds. Well, and as climate change is starting to come, when sea levels are rising, what is your best defense against that? Hydraulic pressure, more fresh water. So when you stop 2/3 of that water from reaching its source in an ecosystem that depends on fresh water, what happens? You get stuff like this. This, unfortunately, is a real story of the spoonbill today. We are down to around 70 nesting pairs in Florida Bay. All because we've disrupted the system so much to the fact that they can't handle it. And we're not making this up. You know, we are watching, just like the snail kites, just like the alligators, we are watching the way wildlife is responding to the system, and that's where we're getting our cues. And so you'll hear it from time to time. You'll hear people say, you know, the Everglades is fragile. It is fragile, but it is not. We brought them down to 2 nesting pairs and they came back. It is resilient because despite all we've done, we have ditched and we've dammed and we've dredged and we've diked it, there are pieces of it like this still remaining. And they are waiting to be put back together. And this is what makes South Florida, well, Florida in particular, so interesting. Because right here, you know, you have that border between this unstoppable force of mankind, which is meeting that immovable object of tropical nature. And it's at that border, it's at that frontier that we have got to start asking ourselves, what is biodiversity worth? What is the value of our drinking water? What is the value of our natural heritage? And fortunately, after years and decades of debate, we are finally starting to act on it. We are investing in the science that can tell us, that can inform our policymakers what the right decisions are. We have people that are dedicating their lives to this science, that are putting themselves in harm's way out in these gnarly storms and these swarms of mosquitoes to tell us the story of what is happening. But it's up to us as citizens and residents to hear them out and to echo their calls. We can make a real change. We really can. Here in North Central Florida, the Everglades is so indicative of the problems we face with water all over the world. And the international spotlight is on us. What are we going to do with the Everglades? People want to know, are we going to fix it? Are we going to heal it? We have to. We must. And the best way to do it, it's fun. Go out. Go see it. Get down there. Spend your money there. Because nothing says I care like I'll pay. It really, really doesn't. Hire a fishing guide. Go spend your money down there. Show the state that making ecologically smart decisions is also economically responsible. We can do it. And if there's one thing I've learned from hanging out with birders all the time, it's never, ever, ever underestimate the power of a birder. They are a fascinating breed because all they want to do is look at stuff through binoculars. And they command a multi-billion dollar industry. How sustainable is that? That is great. But they're not going to keep coming down if there's nothing to look at. We live in a fascinating place, in a place that's unlike any other. But we have some decisions to make, don't we? I love bringing people here. I love taking friends from up north and showing them what old Florida, what the real Florida looks like. You know, the Everglades has one of the darkest places east of the Rockies. You can see the Milky Way bright and clear in the Everglades. And I like showing this side of Florida, this wild Florida, to my friends. When you take them out, you can see that surprise get visual on their face when they're like, whoa, this is like where the wild things are. And this is close by. This water that defines and surrounds our state is critical, not just to us, not just to the wildlife, but to our culture, to who we are, and what we should be proud of. We can make decisions every single day in favor of this magical thing that is the Sunshine State. And all you got to do is go out and experience it. Let it get to your heart, because I promise as soon as you do, it's going to move you to act. It's going to move you to care, and it's going to move you to affect other people. It has me, and I can't shake it. I just can't get rid of it. But I love it. And you can do a lot as a single people or as a group of people. And I'll leave you tonight with my favorite quote. And it's from Margaret Mead. It's never underestimate the power of a small group of committed people to change the world. In fact, it's the only thing that ever has. Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you. Oh. Thank you. Thank you. Oh, God, you guys are too generous. What's that? A
couple of questions.
Yeah, okay. Would you all have any questions? Any questions? Don't be shy.
Obviously, no questions.
Okay. Yes, sir? Sure.
Mac, in the time that you've been doing this photography in the natural environment, have you seen large changes that can be attributed to man-made causes, and are you worried about that?
Well, gosh, yeah, sure. I mean, one of the things that actually set me off on doing conservation photography and kind of photojournalism in a way was I had a place that I used to love to go to in high school. It was my Walden. It was a place I went to every single morning and every afternoon to shoot and to learn. And it turned into a neighborhood eventually. And it really kind of affected me that was my spot. And I thought that it was always going to be like that. And I imagine there are a bunch of places around Florida where people had, you know, their heart connected to, and it's changed. Now, change isn't bad. I live in a neighborhood. I grew up in a house just like everybody else. We need places to live. But it got to me in that this was such a special place, and we need protection of those special places. And so as I was shooting stories in the Everglades, yeah, I saw the massive algal blooms, and I saw the seagrass beds, and those are only attributed to high salinity. And high salinity is caused from lack of fresh water in an estuary. So I guess what I'd like to see is people responding when they see problems like this. What are the counties going to do to protect their special areas and their individual areas of the state? What are they going to do when high salinity is affecting a fishery that is worth billions of dollars and the livelihoods of, you know, hundreds of thousands of people? It's those decisions that we make in the wake of, you know, what science is telling us to make informed decisions. Does that make any sense? Did I answer that question?
I think we have time for just one more question.
Okay, I want to know, how many cameras do you own, and have you ever taken a picture with your iPhone or Android?
You know, they say your best camera is the one that's on you. And, I mean, I've got my camera on me. I do take photos with this. I don't take serious photos with it. I have 4 or 5 cameras. They're all digital bodies. I don't represent any kind of brand. I think they're all great. I've ruined a lot of cameras. But it's fun now. What's really fun is it being digital, you can experiment with so much. We underestimate so much the power of digital that when we used to have film, you'd have to take out your film to change to get to ISO 800 or ISO 400, or you'd have to push your film to get to that. And then you'd have to remember when you take it to develop that, oh yeah, I pushed that film. Wait, did I pull it? No, I pushed it. And you don't ruin your film. Now we have all that with a flick of a button, and it allows us to do some really creative things. And I think that's what's lost in so many people is this new world where it doesn't cost you every time you hit the trigger. And so I use my cameras just as tools. I don't covet them. I don't care for them particularly. I decided a long time ago that my camera was never going to stop me from making a photo. So, you know, if I happen to be out in a rainstorm and I can make a good photo, so be it. You know, I have insurance.
Let's thank our speaker.